The march of scientific discovery and technological development relentlessly continues on. So here are 10 interesting scientific discoveries for November 2023. Number 10. The biggest problem with AI might be its energy use. The question of artificial intelligence and the dangers and pitfalls that lie within the subject have been prominent as of late as the development of AI marches forward. These range from how it's getting easier to cheat on tests and write papers to the question of when is Skynet going to appear, and obsolete humans and all that goes along with that. But one area that hasn't really been widely discussed is that AI is proving really energy expensive, and that may end up being the single defining factor in its future development. Case in point, search engines. If Google switched its entire search engine infrastructure to AI, it would use something on the order of 29.3 terawatt hours per year in electricity. This is comparable to the current usage of Ireland. This would also double that company's electric bill, which is a cost, and converting everything would cost over $100 billion and require far more computer chips, which tend to be limited in supply anyway. That said, chip manufacturing capacity is increasing, and no doubt, so will the prevalence of AI. The usage really is in training large models in AI, which is energy intensive. And there's always room for better efficiency to be developed. And also there has been headway in making smaller AI models work, as well as larger ones. But the fact remains that the energy use question will shape AI development, and it's barely being discussed at this point. Number 9. Gas waves on giant stars. We tend to think of waves as something to do with liquid. After all, the moon causes Earth's tides and contributes to the creation of its waves. But this can actually happen on a much larger scale, with something a bit different from a planet, the surface of a star. This phenomenon happens when you get a very close binary star system under the right conditions. In this system, known as MACHO 80.7443.1718, a smaller companion star is orbiting at times, close enough to disturb gigantic waves on the surface of its supergiant companion. These waves can actually get so large that they can match about one-fifth the size of the star itself and distort the larger star into an oval shape, and it's violent. The larger star is losing mass due to the spray of these giant waves throwing material into space, and the stars are spiraling closer, so this wave phase is only temporary. Whether they will eventually merge is unknown, but this particular system illustrates that binary star systems are very situational and can sometimes produce strange effects on their constituent stars, such as these giant waves. Number 8. A new gigantic crater in the solar system. The Kuiper Belt is not a place where you'd expect to find a huge amount of craters. Collisions can, of course, happen that far out, but the further out you go, the more diffuse everything gets. And while there's a lot of material out there, the chances of collision are less. Though it has to be said that it's far from impossible, with some objects appearing to be barbell-shaped due to two objects touching and coalescing together, as in 486-958 Arrokoth, formerly known as Ultima Thule, that NASA's New Horizon probe explored. In this case, however, a very large crater appears to have been discovered on a Kuiper Belt object. Known as 2002 MS4, this object is an 800-kilometer Kuiper Belt object beyond the orbit of Neptune. Normally, this would not be an object we could directly image its surface in detail. It's very distant and very small. But in this case, researchers were able to capture the object as it passed in front of a distant star, an occultation. The light came back somewhat weird in that part of the object was not round, which is expected for an object of its size. Rather, the northeast corner of the object appears to have an enormous depression in it, consistent with a 320-kilometer crater covering a very large area of this minor planet. In fact, it would be the largest surface feature ever detected on the surface of an object this size, and it ranks up there with the major planets. The rim of this crater appears to be taller than 25 kilometers, which may beat out Mars's Olympus Mons in height, the tallest volcano in the solar system. But this is also not a very direct way of having discovered a crater. Rather, it's possible, though actually more remote than a big crater, is that the object has a moon that's altering the image. Though if it is a moon, then the James Webb Space Telescope should be able to settle that issue, if not image the crater itself directly. Number 7. Exotic lab-grown mammoth meat and beyond. Lab-grown meat cultured from individual cells has been in development for some time, and indeed has come to fruition to a degree. There is lab cell-grown chicken that recently cleared regulatory hurdles and is now being served in a restaurant in California. This holds much promise, but won't be for everyone, at least not initially, in that the main idea is to get away from killing animals directly, but holds the promise of great improvements on meats like beef, where no natural means of production will produce marbling and other desirable traits, such as tenderness, like a lab-grown engineered product will. But there will always be those who don't go that route. But to put a new spin on this, lab-grown products may actually take a turn into new territory, or perhaps old territory, in two distinct ways. The first are meats not normally encountered that people will never try, unless cultured, including things like zebras or lions. But what else can be thought about are DNA reconstructions of what mammoth meat might have tasted like to our ancestors, or for that matter, with enough reconstruction, you might even get close to what the dinosaurs tasted like. Even stranger, perhaps, is the idea of creating meats that correspond to no creature, essentially unicorn meat, that could be tailored genetically to produce flavors unlike anything else, for better or worse. There may come a time in the far future where all meat is cultured, and is fully of our own invention. Number 6. Blue Walker 3. The issue of an increasing number of satellites occupying low Earth orbit is getting worse. While these new constellations of satellite promise great benefits to human civilization, such as internet and communications availability anywhere on the globe where humans exist, it comes with the cost of things like increasingly noisy astronomy. Visually, this is sometimes evident. Starlink, for example, can be somewhat stunning to see after a recent deployment. And the International Space Station passes very brightly overhead regularly, and has done so for many years. But as our satellite presence in low Earth orbit continues to grow, we're gaining more really bright satellites, one of which is known as Blue Walker 3. This satellite is a prototype for a space-based mobile phone network. The problem is that the satellite presents 64 square meters of reflective surface area, making it brighter than most stars when visible. An increasing number of this sort of satellite will present a challenge to astronomy, specifically in all-sky survey telescopes like the coming Vera Rubin Observatory. Really bright objects like this can potentially even damage instrumentation, so the telescopes are likely to have to map out how satellites are moving and basically avoid them when they pass over, institute algorithms to clean the data if one passes by, or outright turn the telescope off while one passes overhead. This is going to add time to observation schedules, in any case. And telescope time is always limited, especially with sensitive or large instruments. One thing that can be done, however, is that the companies running these satellite constellations can institute anti-reflective coatings, or orient their satellites during sensitive observations to not reflect as much sunlight. In addition to this is something less talked about, that of radio astronomy. Downlinks from communication satellites on this level are going to be really powerful. So while a glinting satellite in visual light is comparable to a bright star, in radio astronomy the same satellite can outshine the sun. The answer as to how to mitigate this and find a balance will be something of increasing importance as we build our satellite constellations from here on out. And this will make for a very much more active night sky to viewers on the ground. Number 5. Prehistoric animal tracks accurately depicted by humans. Rock engravings in Namibia dating from about 5,000 years ago have been shown to be more accurate than had been previously thought. The engravings exhibit a myriad of human and animal footprints deliberately carved into rock. The purpose of these carvings is unclear. We know from recent findings in cave paintings in Europe that the paintings appear to have had a practical function, in that they may show in a series of dots and dashes and symbols when the animals of the area bred and gave birth, giving a kind of guide to hunting for anyone that happened to be in the area and be able to read the paintings. It's possible that this might be what's going on with these carvings, but it's impossible to say, other than whoever made them did so with great care to ensure that they were accurate. For the animal tracks, professional trackers were able to identify over 40 species, ranging from rhinos to birds, and even aardvarks, to detail so accurately that the exact species was identifiable, some of which are no longer living in the area, suggesting a different climate at the time. For the human footprints, sex was able to be identified. Why such accurate representations were important enough to painstakingly carve them remains unknown, and may be lost to the mists of time forever. Number 4. The Dwarf Mooing Crocodile. One great challenge to conservationists tracking animal populations is that tracking some of them has proven extremely difficult. One really difficult one has been the African dwarf crocodile, which grows to about 1.5 meters, which is small for a crocodile. They wander all over their habitat in West Africa, from streams to forest, and are difficult to count, and are actually among the most obscure crocodiles on Earth because of it. We know very little about this species. Except we may have a way to track them now, mainly because they make a host of different sounds and vocalizations. These can be low-frequency hums, gusts, rumbles, and even one vocalization that basically sounds identical to a cow mooing. The spectrum of vocalizations these crocs make would be key in tracking and identifying them. Indeed, there was a case where 201 mystery sounds were recorded by elephant specialists in Gabon, and no one knew what they were until this study. It was these small crocodiles. So learning more about the species with microphones seems to be the way to go. Number 3. A Venusian Case of Mistaken Identity. Venus is a planet of mysteries. Indeed, it presents some of the greatest unsolved mysteries of the solar system, to the point that it may have microbial life in its upper atmosphere, supported by a number of completely different hints from unexplained phenomena that happen in that planet's atmosphere. It's every bit as mysterious as Mars or Europa in this regard. Unrelated to that, however, is the mystery of strange flashes of light that are observed in Venus's atmosphere. Much has been made of lightning at Venus, especially in regards to the mysterious presence of phosphine gas in the planet's atmosphere. So much so that a prominent debunker on YouTube attributed the gas to lightning, even though that method of phosphine generation was disproven in the lab 25 years before. Always check the literature. But the actual inference of lightning at Venus itself was never proven either. We don't know that Venus has lightning. Rather, probes would pick up radio static very similar to what lightning produces on Earth, and random lights in the atmosphere. That may well make a case for lightning, and it very well could be there, but the problem was that the two did not correlate, and we're still not certain that Venus's atmosphere actually has the potential to produce lightning at all. That the flashes did not correlate with the static remained a major question. A new study, however, suggests that it may all have been meteors. Venus is nearly the same size as Earth, but experiences less meteor falls in its area of the solar system. But what it does see is different from Earth, in that they are moving at significantly higher apparent velocity on average when they enter, largely because Venus is moving faster than Earth, and as a result, they may be more energetic than meteors on Earth, mimicking lightning. This is important because future probes to Venus's atmosphere are going to need to know if there is lightning there or not. If it's not there, then that might make things significantly easier to prepare for. Still, the lack of correlation between the flashes and the interference is still not understood. Number 2. Plastic may not be problematic forever. Plastic is a problem on many levels. It gets discarded everywhere and it imperfectly recycles, and lasts a long time and can fracture down into microplastics. Part of the reason for this is that it's difficult to make plastic economical to recycle. It's not like glass or metals, which recycle indefinitely. It can't indefinitely be made into new bottles, and the products made from used plastic are limited. The thing is, plastic contains some very interesting materials, and there may be a way to make them into something extremely valuable to reuse: fuel and graphene. This is a weird one. Seeking to find low-cost and more environmentally friendly ways to produce hydrogen led researchers to looking at heating household plastics. This works, and that provides one important resource that could come from our future reuse of plastic, potentially even old plastic recovered from the environment. But here's the kicker: the byproduct is graphene. Graphene is an extremely valuable and extremely useful cutting-edge nanomaterial that promises a great many things, including eventually contemplating things like space elevators. This process seems to be profitable from the start, because even if the graphene were sold at a small fraction of its current market price, less than 5% of it, the hydrogen released becomes free, which also has significant market value. There is money to be made here in two different ways. Of course, that's in the lab. Actually doing it industrially is another matter. But there's a huge amount of room for profit in this one, and if it continues on this path, even old plastic may be useful. And once you lock the carbon up in the graphene, it's not likely to end up in the atmosphere. And the hotter the reaction, the less leftover byproduct there is. Number 1. Antimatter is not antigravity. One of the odd questions that floated around for many years was whether antimatter would actually fall upwards instead of downwards in a gravitational field. Part of the problem is that antimatter annihilates when it comes into contact with normal matter, so it tends to go away before a measurement of its behavior in a gravitational field could be measured. That was until recently, when an experiment was devised to catch a measurement, and it shows that antimatter does indeed fall in a gravitational field and is not antigravity. It was probably never the case that antimatter could have been antigravity. There just wasn't a good reason it would be. It's just a flipping of charges. But it wasn't certain, and you really have to test things before making pronouncements. So that was done with atoms of antihydrogen. But it may open up new mysteries in that what's not yet clear is whether it falls at exactly the same rate as normal matter. And the experiment was not precise enough to tell, but future experiments, should they show a discrepancy, might lead us into the territory of new physics. We shall see. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently pointing out on the behalf of the Mooing crocodiles that they are still crocodiles. We don't know how old that particular species is, but the natural precursor of the cow, the aurochs, if it mooed, only evolved about 2 million years ago. Compare that to the 95 million year history of the crocodiles, which haven't changed much since the age of the dinosaurs. In other words, we should probably say a cow moos like a crocodile, instead of a crocodile moos like a cow. Just saying, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.